NFT. What does one of them go for?
$1.2 million US dollars.
$29 million.
$69.3 million.
Everyone's making so much money. Can you please explain what's an NFT?
When digital art is selling for millions of dollars, there's one big question. How? How can this be so valuable? Especially if I can just...
delete that screenshot.
Oh my God, stop it. Stop.
You've probably seen explanations about the technology behind all of this digital art, also called NFTs.
Runs on blockchain technology.
Blockchain ledger.
A blockchain is a chain of blocks.
But that's never really answered my question of how they can be so expensive. To really understand what's going on here, we have to take a step back and talk about the incredibly strange way that we value art to begin with.
$11,250,000, $13,200,000,
$41 million, sold.
And that story starts not with NFTs, but with a fist fight in 1973. On October 18th, 1973, the who's who of the art world gathered right here in New York City for an event that would change the art world forever. It was being hosted by these two, Robert and Ethel Skull.
They were really some of the first collectors to passionately and in-depth collect living artists, from Warhol to Rauschenberg, Jasper Johns.
That's David Galperin, head of contemporary art for the Americas at Sotheby's.
It's being auctioned at Sotheby's.
Sotheby's?
Sotheby's.
I've been to Sotheby's and they're confident we'll get a good price.
Yeah, that's Sotheby's. They actually owned the gallery that all of this was going down in.
This was the first time that living artists were selling for many tens of millions of dollars.
And people hated it. For a lot of the same reasons that they hate NFTs today, they said it felt gross, like too much of a marriage between art and money.
Art, cold, money.
There's a famous story of Robert Rauschenberg getting into a fist fight in the middle of the auction because he couldn't believe the price at which his work was trading.
I managed to find some of the only footage of that moment. It is the most polite fight I've ever seen.
Let's go. Price set. You didn't even send me flowers.
The artist felt ripped off. He'd originally sold his work for $900, and it had just gone for $85,000. He got none of that. But what was most important is what happened next.
I've been working my ass off for you to make that profit.
How about yours that you're going to sell now?
There. These two men had just exploded art prices forever. And in this moment, they knew it.
That really was the moment that changed everything.
Why do you think that moment happened?
If you think about that time in art history, that was really the moment where living artists became celebrities. You know, Andy Warhol in the 60s, celebrity was his medium. And it was at this turning point when Warhol himself became just as famous, if not more famous, than the celebrities that he captured in his works.
When art becomes more about the artist's personal celebrity or the ideas behind the art than any physical object, it becomes untethered from other benchmarks of value. Lame things like, how much did that cost you to make? Or how long did it take you? Or even, how much do I want that hanging in my house? It becomes, how much is that idea worth? People debate how exactly to measure art prices, but they agree on the direction that they've gone since. Up.
The market has entirely exploded.
And with it, the very idea of what art is exploded too. Art can be text phrases shown in public places, a pile of candy slowly eaten, a banana taped to a wall, even instructions to make the art yourself. This is by an artist named Sol LeWitt.
One of the things LeWitt is famous for are his wall drawings, all of which are site-specific and actually painted or drawn on site. So I think that the question, when we look at it, really depends on what the artist wanted and how they viewed originality.
Yeah, there's this really fascinating quote from Warhol. He said, "I think it would be great if more people took up silk screens so that no one would know whether my picture was mine or someone else's."
With Warhol, he was an artist who loved toying with that notion. There's actually an artist named Elaine Sturtevant, an appropriation artist, whose entire body of work deals with ideas of originality and authorship. And so she would copy works of art by artists like Andy Warhol and Jasper Johns and many others. And actually, with Warhol in particular, Warhol just gave her the silk screen that he used so she could make her appropriations of his work. Wow. So for him, that whole idea of like, what is original and what is a copy is a question that is so integral to the understanding and the appreciation of his art.
When art is branding and concept, it's also hype and ego and speculation and investment. And that applies to basically every kind of art now, not just the weird stuff.
Sold.
Now, a lot of people look at this and they say it with me, money laundering. And it does seem to be the case that there is plenty of money laundering and fraud in the art world. But I think stopping there is kind of a cop-out. You're avoiding the question of why someone would pay so much for this art by just saying they wouldn't. Instead of reckoning with the mind-bendy fact that some people really do pay for the concept behind the art, and what they own is the fact that they bought it.
The actual drawing on the wall is not the artwork. The artwork is the certificate. Without the certificate, the artwork has no value.
Without the certificate, the artwork has no value. You know where I'm going with this.
Delete that screenshot.
The big difference between NFTs and the art that came before them isn't why they have value, it's who decides. With NFTs, there's a new group of people excited about a new kind of art. And the same critic that looked at a banana taped to a wall and said this is worth $120,000 now might look at this and say it has no value. They don't decide anymore.
Okay. All right.
Oh my God, yes. I'm having a bit of a pinch me moment. That is Alexis Ohanian, founder of Reddit and investor, and he's giving me a tour of his NFT collection.
That's one, a little shopping spree. I bought this one. I liked the vibe of it. I liked how it looked aesthetically.
This actually functions also as a ticket to events. So NFTs can have other uses that add other kinds of value. But right now we're just talking about their value as art.
Alexis is married to Serena Williams, which I'm not just saying because she's amazing. This is about to be relevant.
I know you obviously want to see the Serena punks. I have the seventh one I gifted to my wife.
When Alexis gave this to Serena, he transferred the credential, the entry into the database that says who owns it. The reason that NFTs took off now, as opposed to digital images 10 years ago, is because now there's a database that some critical mass of people agree to. It happens to be using a technology called a blockchain, but in theory, it could have been run by Sotheby's or something, if everyone agreed to that.
As long as there is a critical mass of people who believe in it, that is the only database that matters. And so yes, you can right click save to as many different databases as you want. But as long as enough people believe that there's one that truly matters, then it's the one that's gonna win.
If you've ever heard that an NFT is just a link to an image, this is what that really means. It's weirder than you've been told because that's actually where the value is.
Without the certificate, the artwork has no value.
Okay, let's pause here for a second. We've gotten pretty far away from how most of us understand value. It helps to think of an example of what you personally might do. Let's say that you bought a painting. Ugh. You might think that this has value because you have it and no one else does. But as a thought experiment, what if they did?
This is a drawing by Andy Warhol. Last year, an art collective called Mischief bought it for about $20,000. Then they made 999 exact copies. They mixed the original in with the rest, and they sold them each for $250.
So would you personally pay more if you could figure out which the original was? If it came with a certificate of some kind? I think most people would. Maybe because they like it, but also maybe because they think other people would and then they could sell it for more. Now imagine an infinite number of copies. For me, this example really made it clear that even for those of us outside of the art world, value is an incredibly flexible idea. So when someone says, oh, I can just screenshot that, or why do NFTs have any value? They might think they're making a new point, when really, they're just asking the same questions that the art world has been asking for decades. What is value? Where does it come from? What is too much for too little? NFTs are bringing those questions more into the public sphere by taking things to an extreme. What about more money and no physical product and anyone decides? It's like it's the same equation, but NFTs threw a zero in there somewhere and the math is coming out all wonky. But it's the same equation. It makes a lot of people extremely uncomfortable, which is fair. In some cases, we're talking about prices that are just so much more than the price of a house for a digital image. But you don't have to believe every sale price or ever want to buy an NFT or even not hate that other people are spending their money this way to see that NFTs are part of the much larger context of art itself.
in the next 5 or 10 years, we will see a new generation of artists who are creating exclusively with digital in mind. But this is a new medium. The new canvas is this technology, and it's massive.
What's revealed on this new canvas? Us. NFTs are a shiny new thing, and in them, we see our own reflection more clearly than we did before. After all, isn't that the value of art? Hi again. This is where a sponsorship might go, so I want to take a second and talk about how that works. I'm an independent video journalist now, full-time, and one of the ways that people support this work is by doing sponsorships, or ads. I haven't actually done any yet, but I want to be super transparent about how that's going to work for me. The most important thing to know is if it's an ad, you'll know it's an ad. For example, I might do an ad at the end of a YouTube video. It'll be marked as an ad. Or an ad that's just an individual TikTok. It'll be marked as an ad. They do not have editorial oversight into any of the other stuff that I'm making, whether it's in that same video or in other videos or in collaborations or anything else. That's all me. What's interesting about video sponsorships is that you're the one saying them. And as a journalist, that can be kind of interesting. It's more like a podcast read than a television ad. So as the person who might say the ad, the things that I really want you to know are, one, I'm only gonna say things that I actually believe. I'm only gonna work with companies that I actually like. So the things in the ads are true. But two, companies have a say in what's in those ads. So whether that's just drive to this link or they've actually seen a script. But number three, and most importantly, if it's an ad, you'll know it's an ad. Cool? Great.